Okay, so what we were doing in the last class was we were counting number of distinct elements, right? And okay, this part I have covered, that's not a problem. Let's quickly go through the Flageolet-Martin algorithm once again, and we'll go through the last part, the analysis part of this, slowly, because we haven't really finished it. So the idea here is that we will hash each element of the stream to a sufficiently long bit string. And in this case, we thought, okay, we'll hash it to a 64-bit string. So what does it mean by sufficiently long? It should, the number of possible bit strings should be significantly more than the number of possible distinct values, which we are trying to count. So if we are counting different users or distinct users, then 2^64 possible values is way more than enough. So if we choose a 64-bit string, so the memory we need is just 64-bit, okay? And that should work. So essentially what we do, each element comes, we hash it to a 64-bit integer. Let's call the hash function h. Then the tail length, let's define the tail length of a bit string to be the number of zeros at the end of the bit string, okay? That means if the bit string is something like this, okay, this is not 64-bit, but a smaller example, then the tail length of this bit string is 5. Okay, there are 5 zeros at the end. Now the algorithm is amazingly simple. That is, for each element that we encounter in the stream, hash that element to a bit string using the hash function h, and then just keep track of the quantity r, that is the maximum tail length of h a seen so far. So for example, if the first one is this, then the maximum tail length seen so far is 5. Maybe the second one has a tail length, the second one after hashing has a tail length 2, the maximum does not increase. The third one has a tail length 6, then the maximum increases to 6. Okay, so that is my quantity r. Now the now let's try to see why this helps. So how large can r be, capital R be? Obviously, it's a random number, right? So it's a random bit string. Not r is not a completely random number. R is a the bit string is a random one, and then r is the maximum tail length seen so far. Now note that r can only increase. Okay, just what we just said. Okay, the next element comes and it can only increase, right? The more number of distinct elements we see, more will r be. So if you see 100 elements and then if you see another 100, r can only increase. So the more number of distinct elements we see, r is likely to be more, right? Also, if we don't see a new element, then r does not increase. So the tail length of h would not be higher than before, because that tail length of that element we have already encountered, so that cannot increase. So only if we see new distinct elements, then r will increase. Now we need to quantify this above intuition. Now let's do some probabilistic calculation first, and then we will come to why or how we will estimate the number of distinct elements. So the hash function h maps each element randomly and uniformly to that 64-bit bit string. So that means the output of the hash function is random, right? So that means for each of the bits, the probability of that being 0 or 1 are both half. So the probability that a particular bit of HA is 0 is half. Now, the tail length of a bit string is R means the last R bits are 0. Okay, exactly the last R bits are 0, and the from the right side, the r plus 1th bit is not 0, that is 1. So that is the definition of tail length of a bit string being r. This, the r is a small r, okay? So now probability of tail length of some ha being greater than or equal to r, it just means that my last r bits are 0 and I don't know about from the right side, the r plus 1th bit get. So that is 1 by 2 power r, because each bit is independent, the hashing is random. Okay, so then the complement probability that tail length of ha is less than r is 1 minus 2 power r, sorry, 1 minus 1 by 2 power r. And then this happens for one element a. Now if there are m distinct elements, then the probability that no hash value has tail length greater than or equal to r is this scenario for m of them, that is this quantity to the power m. In other words, the maximum tail length is less than r, right? So this probability is the probability that the maximum tail length is less than r. So that probability is this. So we can rewrite this quantity as we push a 2 power r in the exponent here, and we take out that 1 by 2 power r and divide it below m, right? So it's just rewriting this same formula, and we use our favorite approximation, 1 minus epsilon to the power 1 by epsilon is approximately equal to 1 by e for very small e, right? So here e is 1 by 2 power r. Here the small epsilon, here epsilon is 1 by 2 power r. So this this portion is my epsilon. So 1 minus epsilon to the power 1 by epsilon. So this is the epsilon, right? So then my this portion inside the bracket becomes 1 by e. And then the expression is approximately equal to 1 by e power m by 2 power r. Now, if we simply calculate this probability, if m is much larger than 2 power r, then m by 2 power r is a large number. So 1 by e power a large number, it will go to 0. And on the other hand, if m is much smaller than 2 power r, then m by 2 power r is a small fraction, right? So then 1 by this e power a small fraction means that will be close to 1. So 1 by this thing will actually be 1.
Sir, are we assuming r is very large?
Well, even if r is, so in this case, let's say the tail length could be something like, 30, 20, okay? Something like that. Let's say we are using a 64-bit string.
Yes, sir.
Right? So even if r is 20, right? So even if r is 20, 2 power 20 is pretty large. Right? So r doesn't have to be too large, but 2 power r is very large, right?
When we approximate 1 minus 1 by 2 to the power whole power to the power by e, in the same time, in the exponent 1 by 2 to the power is also less.
In the what again?
In the exponent m by 2 to the power r.
Yes.
1 by 2 to the power r is also less.
Yes, but we are approximating only this portion now. Now m can also be very large, right? So m is the number of distinct elements and the data is big. So m can be very large.
Then m by 2 to the power r may be not small.
Yes, exactly. So m by 2 to the power r can be either small or large or approximately equal to 1 or whatever. So this is exactly what we are doing. Okay. So what we see from this calculation is that if m is much larger than 2 power r, then this probability goes to 0. That means what is the probability? The maximum tail length is less than r, that goes to 0. Okay. And if m is much smaller than 2 power r, then this probability goes to 1. Okay. So which means, what is the maximum tail length? Okay. So if m is approximately equal to 2 power r, then we are at a 50-50 scenario. So then it looks like, so that's what we do. We estimate m by 2 power r. So what happens actually is that the number of distinct elements will be approximately equal to 2 power capital R, where capital R is the actual maximum tail length seen so far, because m cannot be too much greater or too much smaller. The definition of capital R is the maximum tail length seen so far. Now, here we see that the probability that the maximum tail length seen so far is less than some r will go to 0 if m is much greater than 2 power r, and will go to 1 if m is much smaller than 2 power r. So what we should do is we should actually think that m is somewhat similar to 2 power r, where a capital R is the maximum tail length seen so far.
Sorry to interject, but shouldn't the value of m be actually much less than equal to 2 power r? Because since if that happens, then the probability tends to 1, right?
No. So there is a bound here, right? It's not equal to r.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that we want to, I mean, the desirable thing is to say that in m distinct elements, no hash value has a tail length greater than or equal to capital R. We want that because
right.
We know that until all the elements we have seen, the maximum tail length can be capital R.
Right.
So we want that probability to be 1, right?
No. Okay. So I got your confusion. So suppose, let's say our maximum tail length seen so far is 10. Okay. So suppose the capital R is 10. Okay. Now, let's consider the probability for different R's. So what if R equal to 5? The statement reads, in M distinct elements, no hash value has tail length greater than or equal to 5. That is not true because the maximum is 10, right? Okay.
Yeah.
So that probability should be very, very small. Right? That probability should be very small. Yeah. So if small R equal to 5, then actually the probability is actually 0. So this side we have, the intuition is clear.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Let's look at the other side. So the other side is, let's say, what is the probability that in M distinct elements, no hash value has tail length greater than or equal to 15? Okay. So what is the probability that no hash value of tail length greater than or equal to 15? That is absolutely 1. Because we know that our maximum tail length is 10. Right. So definitely there is nothing greater than or equal to 15. Right. So it has already converged to 1 and 1 for a long time now. Right. So where can we come back so that the probability is neither here nor there? Okay. So there it will be when m equal to capital R. So let's say 11. Okay. So let's say 11. So in m distinct elements, no hash value has tail length greater than or equal to 11. Okay. Now, if our maximum tail length is R, then in this particular case, of course, we know that there is nothing greater than or equal to 11, but the probability will be very, somewhat closer to 1. And as soon as you go below 10, from 9 onwards, the probability will start to go to 0.
Yes.
So that is where, but then obviously it's an estimate, right? So it is not an exact number. So that is why 2 power R is an estimate for M. Okay, so if you increase, instead of 2 power capital R, if you have any other R smaller, then the probability will go to 0. And if you have a larger one, then the probability will go to 1. You want to stay in the middle, and that is what your right estimate, most likely estimate to be. Okay, let's actually go forward and let's try to see how we use this. And it's also convince ourselves that, okay, this is not a perfect estimate. Okay. So there will actually be lots of problems with this. So then 2 power R is an estimate. What do we mean really? That means if our capital R is 0, that means we have never seen a tail length more than 0, then we have seen one distinct element only. If we see two distinct elements, we are likely to see two distinct tail lengths, so we will not have that. Or in other words, to get if your capital R is around 10, then it's likely that you have seen at least 1,000. You have seen kind of approximately 1,000 distinct elements. That's why your 2 power 10, around 2 power 10 distinct elements. So that is the idea. But then the problem is your estimates are very isolated, right? So you either estimate 2 or a 4 or a 8 or a 1024 or a 2048. You never estimate 1,500, right? So it's a very, very vague estimate. So how do we actually do this. Obviously, one hash function will not be reliable. Okay. So we'll use many hash functions, and that is the usual practice. Now, what we'll do, we'll combine the values of 2 power r to obtain an estimate. Okay, not as estimate, obtain an estimate. How to combine? So we'll use different hash functions, and for each of them, we'll get a tail length, maximum tail length seen so far. And now, should we take an average? So now, if we take an average, we'll take an average of several such 2 power r's, and maybe if you are using 10 different hash functions or 50 different hash functions, maybe that is our good estimate average, right? So, but what is the problem with that? So if we take an average, our expected value of 2 power r should be the number of distinct elements. Then we are happy, at least. So let the actual number of distinct elements be m. So then for some small r such that 2 power r is much greater than m, so that means if we choose a much larger, what is the probability that there is a tail length much larger than tail length, so that 2 power r is much larger than m? So that's always possible, right? We are actually the hashing randomly, so it's always possible that you have actually seen 1000 distinct elements, but there is one of them which is hashed to 1 and then lots of zeros. So which gives you a very large tail length, causing a very bad estimate. So what is that probability? So the probability that some tail length is equal to r for some 2 power r much, much greater than m, let that probability be p. Then the probability that some element has tail length r plus 1 is greater than equal to p by 2, because if this probability is p, r plus 1 means that even the left side bit of that is also zero. So that is another half, you know, multiply that probability by half. Okay. So that is also, that is p by 2 at least. So then you can estimate expected value of 2 power r to be the probability that the value is 2 power r plus p by 2. P times 2 power r plus p times 2 power, actually you can say r plus 1 here, but and so on. So, but then even if we simply replace this by 2 power r, then it will become p 2 power r, p by 2, 2 power r, and so on. And then 1 plus half plus 1 by 4, this is the series you get. And 2 power r in the numerator, and this will actually not converge. So this will go to infinity, where your number of distinct elements is not infinite, right? It's ultimately a big but finite number. So then the problem is average is not the right way to combine. Now, what is happening exactly? That there will be some elements where for which the 2 power r can actually give you a very high estimate. So sometimes your hash function can actually give you a very bad estimate. So when you take a lot of hash functions, not all of them will give you a bad estimate, but some of them will. So if you take the average, you are actually going to overestimate the number very much, right? So then what is the other possibility? Maybe median. So usually when we have some small numbers and some suddenly very large numbers, average is not a good idea, right? So what we do to mitigate outliers, we take median. Now, median is a good idea here, because overestimate will not be a problem. Yeah, there can be some hash functions which will send some very large maximum tail lengths. But then the problem is median is actually one of the numbers, right? One of the 2 power r's. So the median is always 2 power r for some r, which means you either estimate 2 power 10 or 2 power 11 or 2 power 12. And these numbers are far apart, so you are actually never going to estimate something close to your actual number. So we'll combine median and average in the following way. So we'll make groups of hash function and take average of 2 power r for small groups and take the median of the averages like this. So let's say we'll take 5 hash functions. For them, we take the average. We'll take another 5. For them, we take the average, and so on. Let's say in this way, we take 7-8 groups. And then we'll take the median of these groups. Okay. So this essentially is the very simple and extremely efficient approximate way of estimating the number of distinct elements in a stream. You can actually try this out. You can actually try this out by just generating, let's say, 100,000 elements or 500,000 elements or words. Some of them will repeat. Okay, and then just try this. You know how to construct a hash function. So maybe I will set this up as an exercise to for you to implement in Python easily. So the hash function construction is also something we have discussed. Some AX plus B mod something kind of a hash. And yeah, make sure that it goes to a 64-bit bit string, and or 64-bit, or if you take 500,000, much smaller bit string should do. And just try this out and see what kind of results you get, right? So that could be a good exercise. So I'll actually set this up as an assignment. Intuitively, this algorithm does sound a bit too simple to work. So we'll actually try this out in practice.
Sir,
okay.
How small the groups should be?
There is nothing concretely written in the literature. I mean, why don't you try and figure this out? So I also exactly don't know what kind of groups you should use, but I think let's say groups of five, and if you take 10 groups, right? So then what you have to do for every stream element, you have to hash 50 times, or maybe take groups of four or three and five groups. So then hash 15 times. You know, try small, and then if you get an accurate estimate, then we'll see that, okay, that's good enough, right? One can probably work out the probabilities of this grouping and all those things in more detail, but let's not go into that. We have many other topics to cover. Let's take this up numerically and experiment on this and see how it works out. Of course, I said I'll set this up as an assignment, but I will actually clearly write it down for you to follow the instructions of how to do things or what to do. So it's just this is not a verbal assignment. I will actually send you a write up for the assignment. Okay. So the next thing is a concept of moments. I wish I can cover two more topics today, but they are not so long. So probably let's see. So suppose a stream has elements chosen from a set A. Chosen means, let's say a stream is a set of numbers, or a stream is a stream of numbers, and I know that the numbers are, all the numbers are between, let's say 0 and 10,000. Suppose that is the case. So then my set is 0 to 10,000, right? So something like that. So set of words, set of email addresses, anything like this. Okay, so suppose a stream has elements, and let mi be the number of times the value I occurs in the stream. That means if it's a set, you can order them, right? The first element, second element. So you are basically labeling the elements. So the mi be the number of times the value I occurs in the stream. Then the definition of the kth moment is, for all the elements in the set, the global set, mi to the power k. Okay, so let's actually see a small example. So let's say my set of elements are between 1 and 5, right? So let's try 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 1, 5, right? So what would be my... So with that being the example, let's move. Oh, I cannot move on the slide. Okay. So what would be the zeroth element? That is mi to the power 0 for all I. So what are my elements? So my elements are 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. 1 is appearing 4 times. So 4 to the power 0 plus 2 is appearing twice. So 2 to the power 0 plus and so on, right? Okay, so that is the case. What will be the first element, mi to the power k for I equal to? So 1 is appearing 4 times, so 4. 2 is appearing 2 times, so plus 2. 3 is appearing 1, so plus 1. 4 is appearing 1, so plus 1. And 5 is appearing 1, so plus 1. So that's the idea. Now, Yeah, okay, I can keep it. Yes, so the zeroth moment, interestingly, is simply the number of distinct elements, because for every element you are counting one. For every distinct element appearing, you are not counting the number of times it is appearing, right? So mi is the number of times it is appearing, but you are actually taking to the power zero. That means you are counting one. So zeroth moment is the number of distinct elements, right? So which we have just considered the problem in the previous section. Now, first element is a count of the number of elements. That is the length of the stream. Why? If the first element is occurring four times, you count four. The second element is occurring two times, you count 2^1, right? So again, you count two and so on. So the first moment is simply the number of elements in the string with duplication, which means length of the string. So that is also very easy to count. So this is extremely easy to compute. Nothing really interesting here. I mean, at least computationally, nothing interesting here. So the second moment onwards, things are going to get interesting. Okay, so I can actually delete my annotation now. Yeah. So the second moment is actually a measure of how uneven a distribution is. Okay, so why? So let's say consider a stream of length 100. So stream of 100 elements, and let's say there are 11 distinct values. So let's say the first value occurs 10 times, and all the others occur 9 times. This is not the stream. This is the count of the distinct elements, each of them. So then my S, or surprise number, or second moment, is equal to 910, because I have 10 square plus 9 square times 10, which is 810. So that is 910. Now, suppose we again have a stream of length 100, but again we have 11 distinct values, but the counts are now different. So the counts are 90. One element occurs 90 times, all the others occur once only. Then the surprise number is 90 square plus, you know, 1, 1, 1, so 10 of them. So that is 8100 plus 10, that is 8110. So the second moment increases when you have more unevenness in the counts. This is a very even case, right? This is a very even case. Most of them occur 9 or 10 times, or all of them occur 9 or 10 times. This is a very uneven case. At least one of them is very uneven. So essentially, the second moment is a measure of how uneven a distribution is. So there we will study one algorithm for estimating second moment. So obviously, as you see, counting zeroth moment or counting first moment directly from the stream, zeroth moment we can use the Flageolet-Martin algorithm, and first moment is simply increment one, right? So that is, those are trivial. But second moment, then you actually have to count how many times each element occurs, and that's not such an easy thing, because every time you have to see, okay, have I seen this, how many times it occurs, and all those things, right? So that's not easy. So we'll have to actually use some approximate estimate for that.
Sir, hello.
Yes.
Sir, there is no bound of M2, the second moment. So you told that it's a measure of unevenness. So
yes.
how uneven the stream is, so there is no bound for M2.
No, there is, of course. I mean, given this, if you consider a portion of the stream where a number of elements, total number of elements you are considering is right finite, right? So obviously, using some AMGM kind of inequality, you can show that there will be a bound, right? Because the second moment is ultimately, the smallest is every element occurs once, right? And the largest is one element occurs all the time and no other element occurs at all. So the size of the stream is square.
Right? Yes.
So obviously there is a bound. So that's a straightforward application of your AMGM inequality. All right. So to start with, assume a finite set of size n, not an infinite stream. Now, in reality, nothing is. It's not a mathematical infinity, but we'll see what we mean by infinite stream a little bit later. So suppose we are actually considering this on a big set or big portion of a stream, and let's develop our algorithm based on that, and then we'll figure out other things. So suppose this is our stream. Now this is the portion that we are considering. So the algorithm goes in the following way. So we'll describe the steps, and in example, the specific example will be given in brackets. So let's say we pick a position between 1 and n. So this is the first position, nth position, right? Size n, uniformly at random. And let's say we pick the sixth position. Okay, so we pick the sixth position. Okay, so that in this example, let's say we are doing that. So suppose randomly we have picked the sixth position. Then consider the element at that position. So consider the element in that position x equal to a, our value is a, right? Be seen for the first time at this position. Now, this is not true, right? Because A should have been seen before, but consider that we have randomly picked a position and this is where I have seen this for the first time. Then we'll set x dot element equal to A, that means like a key or something. So x dot element equal to A and x dot value equal to 1. So the value is meant to be the count. So I have seen A for the first time now and the count is 1. Anytime A is seen again, increment x dot value. Okay, so like we see A again, we increment the value to 2, okay, and so on. Okay, now, and this way we go on to the end of the stream. So all that we do is we check whether is this my element chosen. If yes, we increment, otherwise we don't. Now, why is it computationally different from actually explicitly doing the whole thing? I mean, we could as well do first C element A, count 1, B, count of B is 1, C, count of C is 1, B again. Oh, I have seen B before, so count of B becomes 2. So that would have been the straightforward algorithm, right? Exact count. No, that would be a problem if we have lots of distinct elements. Then we have to maintain counter for too many of them. Then the lookup problem comes up. Here we have only one. Okay. In general, we will have only a small constant number of such things. So we have picked a random position and we have picked that lucky element A. Okay. And all we are doing, we are not looking it up into a big set, rather checking equality with one element only. Okay. Obviously, as you can guess, we will not stick to one element. We will generalize this a bit more. But then also it will only be, let's say, 5 elements only or constant number of elements only. So rather checking equality with one element only. So that's efficient, right? We're just checking whether this is equal to this.
Sir, yes. If the number of elements, I mean, if the number of distinct elements is large,
yes,
then even we have to look up for that element because we have to check whether set x dot element equal to b and find the value. So we
No. We don't care about other elements at all.
No, no. I'm not saying about other elements. For example, let us consider that we have seen A for the first time and they've incremented the value of A to 1. Okay.
So A is here first time 1, A value is 1.
Yeah.
Okay. So and then, go on.
So my doubt is that, for example, suppose that the number of distinct elements of distinct positions where A is present is pretty large.
Right.
So every time we encounter A, we have to find out that value and increment it by that number.
No, no. So it is just something you already have in memory. It's a constant memory, right? There is no lookup involved.
Okay, so number of distinct elements large means we have to look up for the distinct value also.
No. We are only, so, okay, suppose our goal is just count how many times A is present, nothing else. We don't care about the number of, okay, so that is what we are doing right now. We have chosen A to be our lucky element and our goal is just count how many times A is present, nothing more.
Okay, thank you.
Not other elements. Okay, just one element.
Yeah, that's clear.
Okay. Thank you. So that is the point. So now this is easy. This is computationally not a problem. So now what we'll do, go till the end of the set. So obviously x dot value will become something. So in this case, my x dot value will be 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Okay. A is present 4 times from here. So x dot value will be 4. Okay. That is not my answer. The second moment will be estimated as small n, that is the total length of the stream, times 2 into x dot value minus 1. Okay, why such a strange expression? Let's actually do a little bit of exercise and then we'll come back to that. So now, obviously, as I said, here we had only one lucky element. We'll not take one, but we'll take a few lucky elements. But no, so your number of distinct elements could be millions. So we'll not take all of them. Maybe we'll take 10. Maybe we'll take 5. Okay. So very small number of, basically constant number of elements. So then every time you are actually doing a lookup into a constant, small constant number of elements. So that is in memory and that is a very quick check. So you're simply increasing the comparison to 10 times. Let's see, if you're taking 10 elements, instead of checking whether x equal to a, every time you are checking whether x equal to any of these. Okay, so if you are on an average, you will actually do 10 by 2 comparisons, or maybe on an average, you will actually do 10 comparisons if you are taking 10 random positions. So let's actually do that for this particular case. So on top we have the positions and bottom we have these. So let's say length equal to 15. So randomly picked 3 positions, 2, 8 and 12. Okay, so x1 dot element is B, 2, right? Position 2, x2 dot element is D, so position 8. And x3 dot element is C, position 12. Then at the end of the data, our B is present 1, 2, 3, 4 times. Okay, x1 dot value 4, x2 dot value will be 2, and x3 dot value will be 1. Note that C, my position picked is 12, so I'm not considering its presence until this. Okay. Now, the estimate n times 2x dot value minus 1 for the first one is 105, the second one is 45 and 15. If you take the average, it becomes 55. And if you actually compute the second moment for this, you know, explicitly, it is 59. So in this case also, it's actually quite good. But obviously, this is an example. So examples can always be made nice. But well, that's not really the problem. The good thing is it will actually work pretty well, because the expected value of this quantity n times 2 x dot value minus 1, the way we define it, equals the second moment. So the point is, if we actually take a large stream and the actual second moment of that stream is equal to the expected value of, what if you expected value of, if we do this and you know, come up with this expression. Okay, so that is why, well, if you do with one lucky element, yes, the expected value is that, but well, you may get a bad estimate. But if you take a few lucky elements and then take the average of the estimates, then you're expected, I mean, you are much more likely to get a better estimate. Okay, so so this is again a very interesting thing. Again, you can see that the backbone of all these algorithms are probabilistic approximations. We are not, at this point, we're not going into the derivation of why this is the expected value. We'll actually move on to the next topic. But yeah, so maybe you can try to read this up, or you can try this as an exercise, or you may not try. This is all fine, because it's true and it's not that difficult to try it out. So yeah, so that's the lesson from the Alon Matthias Sejeji algorithm for estimating second moment.
Sir, hello.
Yes. Go on.
Can you please explain one more time how you are getting this estimate of n times 2x, 2x dot value minus 1, how you are getting this this figure, how getting this number?
Right. So we have not explained that, right? So we have not explained that. I'm not going to explain that right now. So we have to work it out probabilistically. The thing is that the expected value n times 2x, 2x dot value minus 1 is same as, if we do this, if we pick a random position and we count the number of times this element, whichever element in that position is, occurs after that position or since from that position, and define x dot value by that, then the expected expect this, the expected value of this will be equal to the second moment. Okay, so that we have not derived it in the class.
Yeah, that derivation you haven't shown yet, but we are assuming it and working and getting these figures.
Right. At this moment, yes. So this is, you are taking this as if it is true. Right. Okay.
Okay.
Hello, sir. Yes. Hello. So, sir, does not it matter whether an element appears for the first time or not in the position that we choose randomly?
No, that is the point. So if you do that, then you will overestimate a lot, right? So suppose you choose this position, right? If you choose this position, then you are actually missing out on this count, missing out counting A for the first position, right? And that is what you have to do. If you don't do that, then your expected value will become much larger. So what happened was, if you can see that if your randomly chosen position is a small number, then what you get is a large number, because your count will be high. However, your randomly chosen position also can be a large number with respect to the total size, like a 12, then your count is a small number, then your 2 x dot value minus 1 is small, right? So that randomness actually ensures that the expected value is the second moment. Otherwise, you are going to have a huge overestimate. So that is the trick. So you actually going to miss all the counts, all the occurrences of this element before this. All right?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So what I suggest is, I'll have to actually check back. I have not seen it very recently. I'll have to check back whether the book by Leskovec, Rajaraman and Ullmann has the derivation for this expectation. Well, if it has, then, you know, please go and read up. If it doesn't have, then in the doubt clearing session, maybe I can work it out for you. Or, I mean, it should not be that I should work it out. I should work out everything for you. So please try. Okay. If you get it, it's excellent. Okay. If you don't get it, then I will work it out for you. All right. So obviously, if it's there in the book, just read it up, because we won't be able to cover every detail in the class otherwise. So now, I think we'll finish this AMS algorithm for infinite streams, and not more than this in this class. And I'll actually leave out the decaying window portion for you to read up. I'll not ask questions from there, but it's pretty easy. So technically, we assume that the size of the data is small n, right? So we assume the size of the data is small n, but what happens is, but then your stream is actually coming, right? So if the size of the data is small n, then probability of picking each position for a variable x is the same. So for example, our size was 15, and the probability of picking any particular position was the same, 1 by 15. For infinite data that keeps coming in a stream, the scenario has to be different. What should be the scenario? Okay, it should depend on how much data have we seen so far. So the size of the stream, infinite data, means that the size of the stream is n now, but in the next instance, the size of the stream is n plus 1. So the size of the stream keeps increasing. So to maintain our probabilistic invariant of the expectation, we have to do something to adjust this. So the approach one is pre-select S positions previously. Okay. I mean, like one position, instead of one position, we select, let's say, S positions previously. And at some point, all S positions are selected. So that means you previously determine you have 10 positions. The first one is 15, the second one is 1000, the third one is 1 million, the fourth one is maybe 1,000,005, and so on, right? So when the data starts to come, initially you don't have any position that has actually arrived. So your first position will arrive at some point. So it's more like, it's more like, where am I? Yes. Yeah, it's more like your stream is arriving. So even if your random position is here, initially you didn't have it. So first you only seen this, then you have seen this, but you haven't seen this position yet. Okay, so it's something like this. So now, but then n keeps growing. So after all your positions you have seen, you will not update your data anymore, right? You will not update your count anymore. You will not update your these elements anymore. So what will happen is, after a while, all your positions are too small for your total stream size, and your x dot values will only increase, right? So you will get an overestimate. The second approach is you maintain the probabilistic invariant that the probability of picking any position is the same, and that is the probability of picking any position is 1 by the size of the stream, but the size of the stream keeps changing. So at any point of time, your probability should be 1 by n if the size is n, but if the size becomes n plus 1, you should change the probability to be n plus 1 by n plus 1. So how do we do this? So the size n keeps growing, but the number of positions is limited. So what we do, we must keep the chosen positions dynamic. That means we should drop some positions. We should drop some elements from our lucky chosen ones. So that means also estimate on the moment is dynamic, but that is true because your stream is dynamic. So after S positions are selected, if a position S plus one is also selected, that means if you choose a new position, then you must discard one of the previous positions. So how to do that? So let's say you have S positions. In our example, we had 3 positions. Okay. So just suppose that after 15, you still keep getting more data. Okay. So at some point you will say, oh, no, I should not stay with my 3 positions. I will have to drop one of them and take a new position. So let's say n is the size of the stream so far. So the invariant we have to maintain is the probability that position among 1 to n is selected must be s by n, because you are choosing s positions. No problem till the first s positions are selected. But after that, when the next element arrives, n plus 1th element arrives, the probability of each of the n plus 1 positions being selected should then be, well, this quantity where, well, I'll explain. This is the probability of pick position n plus 1 with probability n s by n plus 1. This each previous n positions were selected with probability s by n, but now each of them remains with probability s minus 1 by s, because you have to drop one of them. And this is with this probability the n plus first position is not picked and the previous selected positions retain their probability. So there are two possibilities. One is you pick the new position with this probability, n plus 1th position with this probability, and you drop one of them, one of the existing ones. And this is the portion where you actually don't pick the new one and you just keep the previous ones, right? So then what happens, this quantity, if you simplify, I'll quickly move through this. It is just simple calculation. You will actually get s by n plus 1, which is what you want. Okay, so for n positions, when the size of the stream so s position, when the size of the stream was n, your probability was s by n, but when the next element comes, your probability will remain s by n plus 1, and this is what exactly you want to maintain. So the invariant is maintained when the size becomes n plus 1, the probability of each position being selected is s by n plus 1, and then the formula of the expectation will still follow. All right, so I think that's pretty much it. I'll just quickly show you what's there in the decaying window portion, just because it's an interesting topic. But I think we'll move to the next chapter from the next class. And tomorrow we have a doubt clearing session. And maybe this Friday we can take a quiz on the last couple of chapters. So this is essentially like trending hashtags and so on, recent trending hashtags. How do you put more weightage to recent ones and less weightage to slightly less recent ones, right? So that is the idea behind this. You can just, I think, just read it up and read up the book as well. I'll not ask you questions, but it's actually something very interesting to know. All right. So that's it.
Sir, can you just please once again explain the position part in that? No, calculation is fine. You start with that previous to this slide.
This one?
Yeah. That position, pre-select S positions.
Right, okay. So let's actually explain from here.
Yeah.
So here what we did was we said, okay, we pick three positions.
Okay, okay.
In
okay.
general, our S is three. I mean, sorry, in general, our three becomes S. Okay. So
in this case, S is three, right?
In this case, S is three. So okay. what we did, we derived our algorithm on a fixed size, right?
Okay.
And what we maintained was, we have a stream or we have data of size 15. So what we must have that, and we pick three positions. So the probability of any of these positions being picked is 3/15.
Yeah.
Okay. And that will be important in this derivation later on.
Okay. Now,
but in an actual stream, our 16th element will come, then 17th element will come, and so on.
Fine.
Suppose we have already picked our three positions. So what will happen is, as you can see, if our positions picked are early with respect to the size of the stream, then eventually our numbers will become very large. X dot values become large.
Okay.
And we'll get higher estimate. We'll get higher estimate. So fine. What will fine. Happen is, if we keep the same positions, our B, D and C, and our stream size becomes 1000, 15, 16, blah, 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 then 1000, then the counts will just become larger, but maybe that is actually not the second moment. The second moment will not be so large.
Okay.
We'll get a higher estimate. So what we should do when the next element comes, what should be our invariant? Our invariant should be, we'll still have three positions, but the probability of picking any of the 1 to 16 positions should be 3/16, not 3/15.
Okay.
So this is what we are doing. So what we are doing is, we will pick the 16th one with probability 3/16. But if we pick it, we must drop one of the previous ones.
Okay.
So we must change one of our elements, x1, x2, x3. If we pick it. Or we will not pick it with probability 1-3/16. And then we maintain our previous elements.
Okay.
Okay, so that is essentially what is happening.
Okay.
If we do this, then our what will happen at the after my 16th position, the we'll still stand in the same thing. Okay, the picture will still be similar. What may happen, however, is that if we interchange, if we drop and if we insert the new position, then my elements may change. Maybe we have dropped x1, then x1 dot element can actually be what is new here. Okay, but then we count from there. We start the count from there. So then x1 dot value will be 1 to start with.
Okay.
Okay, so that is how we prevent overestimating. All right?
Okay.
Okay. So fine, sir, then. Yes.
Sir, which one do we drop?
Oh, we drop again randomly. So, so approach 2 is, after S positions are selected, if the S plus 1 position is selected, one previous position is discarded, again, you have your S previous positions, right? So if you have for each N positions were selected, now each of them will remain with probability S-1/S. Or that means each of them will be dropped with probability 1/S. So in this example, if you select a new position, then your previous three positions, I mean, you will drop with probability 1/3. So you will actually basically randomly choose one of the three and drop that.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else as of now?
Sir, tomorrow doubt clearing session is from 2:15.
2:15. Yes. Tomorrow 2:15.
Sir, you please upload the slide today.
Yes. Yes. Obviously. I'll upload the slides. I think these slides are already there. But I will update. I'll update the slides again. Yes. Okay. All right then. So